good afternoon. My name is Brian Joseph, and I'm the Senior Director for Asia and Global Programs at the National Endowment for Democracy. Welcome to the NED. Our event this afternoon examines the role of economics in Burma's transition from 50 years of authoritarian rule to, as Larry Diamond eloquently writes in the JOD, something else. There's little debate that economics will play a central role in the transition, and I very much look forward to hearing today's discussion of this topic. Gwen Robinson, Senior Fellow at the Institute of Security and International Studies at Chulalongkorn University in Bangkok, is our presenter today. The discussion will be moderated by Anne Applebaum, Director for Global Transitions at the Legatum Institute. A list of our participants and our speakers' biographies can be found on the handout available outside the main doors to this room. This event is part of a larger initiative looking at the role of economics in democratic transitions, organized in partnership with the NED's International Forum for Democratic Studies, the Legatum Institute, World Affairs, and the Democracy Lab. This is the third case study in the series. Previous analysts discussed the cases of Tunisia and Kenya. Those events are viewable online at www.ned.org/events. Although it is difficult to say with much confidence what is happening in Burma today, and even more difficult to say where the country is heading, what is clear is that the change taking place is profound. The transition in Burma is often framed primarily as a political transition, but that is only one of a number of transitions underway in Burma today. Burma is moving from military dictatorship to some form of controlled but contested political arrangement, from isolation to regional and global integration, from protracted civil war to negotiated peace, and from international pariah to international darling. And as our speaker will discuss, Burma is also moving away from 50 years of disastrous economic policy, which has left the country one of the world's poorest and least developed. Burma is still in a very early phase of transition, and its future path is uncertain. For the transition to succeed, the government will need to adopt economic policies that unlock Burma's economic potential, and which allow for the emergence of a truly free market economy, and not one dominated as it is today by military economic holding companies and cronies. I would note that you can follow the conversation on Twitter using the hashtag NEDEvents, or by following the International Forum at Think Democracy. Thank you all again for coming, and I'm now pleased to hand the floor over to Anne Applebaum, who will moderate the discussion.
Right, thank you very much. I'm really pleased to be here with Gwen, who asked me to point out that although she's described here with a very grand title, as am I, Senior Fellow, Institute of Security International Studies, she is primarily a journalist, and has been a journalist, and has spent all of her life as a journalist, and much of it at the Financial Times. And she's writing as a very frequent visitor and observer of Burma as well. She's going to talk just a little bit. She's actually done a paper, which will be, in due course, will appear both on NED's and on the Legatum Institute's websites. And today she's going to introduce some of the ideas of the paper. She'll speak for about 15 or 20 minutes now, and then I'm going to ask her a few follow-up questions, and then we'll have discussion with the audience. I know this is a very educated audience, which is well-versed in Burma and Burmese events, and so I'm hoping you'll all participate as much as you can or want to. Anyway, Gwen.
All right, okay. First, yes, as Anne said, I've covered Burma largely as a journalist, and then later on more recently, working on deeper stuff for essays and a possible book. So a lot of my insights have come from direct interviews, including directly with the President, Thein Sein, and various cabinet ministers, going to Parliament quite a lot. So over the years, I first started covering it in late 2011, which is just around the time that I think people had been very skeptical about this new government when it came in March 2011. We'd been through elections that were widely condemned as fraudulent. You know, the old dictator Tan Shui had sort sort of insisted he was following the roadmap to democracy. It didn't all seem very democratic. And this little general came into power and announced he was going to do lots of reforms, and everyone just yawned. And then suddenly things started happening gradually, but I think the seminal moment was in September 2011, when there'd been mounting complaints. Well, one was Aung San Suu Kyi being released, but there'd also been mounting complaints and campaigning about the Nitsone Dam, the Chinese hydropower project in the northern Kachin state. And suddenly, one day, across the wire came an announcement that Myanmar's government had decided to suspend the dam project, $2.4 billion, and subsequently it became very apparent that they had not even bothered to inform Beijing before that announcement went out. So we all began paying a lot more attention to Myanmar. It was still very hard to get access those days. One measure of how much things have changed is that I now have a long multiple entry visa. I noticed the other day there was an announcement that they're thinking of allowing foreign resident visas in Myanmar. All this sort of indicates such great change, but these are little indications. The really important trend, I think, that I've seen lately is that what we've got going here is a breakdown of the old order as we knew it. So there's been a lot of conspiracy theories that, this is all a ploy. There's a lot of cynics out there who say that the military knows full well what it's doing. It's in control. Tan Shui, the former dictator, announced his roadmap to democracy, shuffled off, but he's pulling the strings in the background. There might be an element of that in those conspiracy theories, but actually, I think what we've also got going is something beyond what the generals really thought they were going to roll out here. And what we've got is a metamorphosis or a breakdown of the old order, a transformation of some of the old power centers. They're either breaking up or metamorphizing into slightly different types of organizations and power centers. You've got the rise of new ones, including, I'd say, parliament, which is, we have to remember that there was not a parliament 3 years ago in Myanmar. It has become a ferociously activist body, which often sends back bills to the president. The president makes suggested changes. Increasingly, those changes are ignored. it summons cabinet ministers, it grills people. Most of all, there's been particularly ferocious battles over legislation, critical legislation, such as foreign investment law, telecommunications law, budgets. In 2012, the first budget that was presented to Parliament, Parliament decided to reject it. There had to be a lot of horse trading. I know some of you in the audience, I know, have called it, democracy in action. And up to a point, that's true. But I don't think also we should forget that this parliament, this activist parliament that has embraced the parliamentary process so enthusiastically, is actually made up 80% of 25% military officers who have an allocated seat. And then we've got the military-backed USDP ruling party, which has a lot of candidates that really were not elected what you'd call fully democratically. They came to power in elections that were condemned as flawed. So it will only be after the elections at the end of 2015, I think, that you'll really see a fully democratic parliament. Nevertheless, you've got this body being very activist, but beyond that, you've got many, many other new power centres emerging. And it's worth remembering that some of them are not so positive. On the positive side, you've got things like unions, which were illegal 3 years ago. There's now just about, I talked to the ILO representative recently in Myanmar, there's just about 1,000 unions now which have been set up in just the space of 2 years. A lot of them have had strikes, have managed to exert their influence, get better conditions, increase pay. There's now discussion they'll have a minimum wage by the end of the year. You've got civil society, which is a very important new power centre, exemplified by Generation 88, the group made up of former political prisoners. They've almost become like a political party come activist group, and they may yet become a proper political party. There's been heated debate, and I think they've decided for now they won't take that step, but I wouldn't be surprised if they do form a party for elections. They're out there organising farmers, labour unions. They were instrumental in the protest at the copper mine, where a lot of protesters were injured. They're helping local people in the countryside fight back against land grabbing. So this is an extremely important power centre. You've got independent media. Last year was the first time a daily newspaper was allowed to be published. Now you've got licences given to about 22 daily newspapers. This is both a positive and a negative force. I think on the positive side, they've taken to Western-style journalism very enthusiastically. There's some very good, diligent newspapers that are recording everything, business, parliament. A lot of it is learning on the run. They never had a free and independent press that wasn't censored. On the other hand, you've got this incredible growth of tabloids that would make Fleet Street blush. You know, they've got sort of scandals coming out every third day, you know, some cabinet minister's daughters having an affair with a Chinese tycoon, and, you know, none of it, there's no libel laws. Well, there is actually, but it's not like it is in America or Britain where there's much recourse. Some of the stories are outlandish and can be, you know, there are real pressure, I think, on both the government and other and business to deal with that kind of mixed media. So that's one. And on the very negative side, you've got the rise of things like activist monks. The monk, one of the most dangerous, who's leading the 969 movement that's behind a lot of the sectarian violence we've seen in Myanmar, was in jail for many years under the previous regime, which people tend to forget because the previous regime had such a bad name. But actually, there was very little of what we're seeing now right across Myanmar, and I'm sure you're all familiar with and have read maybe pundits and commentators blaming, in a way, or blaming or attributing it to the new democratic environment where there's very few restrictions on organising groups, and hence you've got these, you know, last week there was a meeting of 10,000 monks in Mandalay, and they happily resolved to oppose interfaith marriages, and there was a subgroup in there that was planning how to drive all Muslims out of Rakhine State by the end of the year. So, you know, under the new democratic environment, they're allowed to meet and do these sort of things. But now there's talk of bringing in hate speech laws. But like everything else in Myanmar, it's all happening at once, and this government is very stretched in capacity. So at the same time as they're dealing with all these competing new power centres across a broad range of fields, from, you know, religious to social to political and business, where I should mention that unlike the yesteryear when you had shadowy so-called cronies, I don't like that word, but, you know, for want of a better word, well-connected tycoons that were close to certain powerful people in government, you know, we have those here in America and in England and all over the place, but that was a certain kind of economic order, the crony economy. Now you've got the main business group, UMFCCI, almost acting as like an arm of government and like, you know, the American Chamber or something like that. They're hosting foreign business groups, they're facilitating, helping legislation that affects business. They were extremely constructive in drafting the foreign investment law and many other laws that do affect business. So that also has become like a real power centre. You know, sure, the old cronies are still there and there's probably new ones rising. There are favoured business people, favoured by various arms of the government and politics. But at the same time, I think this is really emerged as a different kind of business group. say, well, the list goes on of these new power centres, but as I said, it gives the government really a lot to deal with at this particular time. My other point was going to be, because I'll try and keep this short, I just wanted to download some of the recent observations I've made in my numerous trips there. But I think what's also happening, which is interesting, is that the fault lines for the battles we're seeing in places like Parliament and in society at large, actually, have shifted from the whole sort of vaguely right-wing, left-wing, pro-military versus pro-democracy, the whole kind of, you know, evil shadowy dictator versus the, you know, fair maiden Aung San Suu Kyi pro-democracy martyr. It's gone beyond that. The new fault lines are really the economic protectionists and populists against, you know, pro-liberalisation, laissez-faire types. One of the big dividing issues now is the extent to which foreign investment and foreign companies will be welcomed in and facilitated in Myanmar, which is why there was such a huge fight over the foreign investment law, which went on for nearly 12 months in Parliament and saw a lot of heated debate about, particularly about provisions of, you know, how much should foreign investors have in terms of incentives and tax rates. We're seeing the same kind of arguments come up over the special economic zone law, where some of the pro-market types in Parliament and also in government want provisions like, you know, big foreign investors that come into a special economic zone. Special economic zones are supposed to be to draw investment to create jobs and produce goods that are for export, but the Liberals want to make provisions that will enable foreign investors to come and set up shop and sell into the domestic market. At the moment, Myanmar doesn't make very much. I mean, it's big on garments, on growing rice, on seafood, nothing that sophisticated. But increasingly, as foreign investors do come in, they're seeing a lot more of these factories and technology transfer at a reasonably low level, but given the speed with which the country has moved in the last 3 years, I would not be surprised if there's a lot more expertise acquired very rapidly. So, you know, that's really something to watch for, because I think the dividing lines are much more confusing now than they were, because I'm not saying you can easily slot someone as pro-reform, pro-market, and protectionist. I mean, you know, today's protectionists will be on the other side tomorrow over another issue. And most interestingly, to watch the military votes in Parliament. You know, sometimes you've got the military representatives voting for a bill that maybe the NLD, Aung San Suu Kyi's party, is producing. So, in fact, a lot of the lines are blurred. So I'm just giving you that as a general observation about these kind of new divisions. And above all, I should, before I pass back to you and talk about the military. So my other observation, and I know some of my journalist and also academic colleagues who are convinced that nothing's changed and the military is fully in control and calling the shots and has no intention of leaving the centre of governance of the nation, will scoff at this. But I really do believe that there's some diminution of military power. I don't know how voluntary that is or how much that's coming from the top, but some very concrete signs are. I was just looking at the budget request for this year for the various sectors. Tain saying the president is going ahead with vows to vastly increase spending on health and education. There's increased expenditures on areas such as that and social welfare type of programs. Meanwhile, the military's budget, I notice, has gone down to 12% of the total budget request for this year. I mean, 5 years ago, it was about 24%, 25%. I'm sure there's people in the audience who could correct me or know a lot more detail about military budgets and how they were spent. And I'm well aware that there was, as in many authoritarian regimes, are kind of slush funds and discretionary spending. But even that has come up in Parliament. You've got parliamentary committees, budget committees, demanding to know more detail about about discretionary spending of the military, which up to recently has been a real sacred cow. No one asks the military to explain how and why they spend their money. So that's one real indication to me. And another one is the radical cuts in force numbers. So these numbers, you know, numbers were very rubbery in the earlier days, but all the experts that have had some access to military records, and I'm sure there's a couple here as well, but people like Andrew Self and Mary Callahan have come up with the figure of about 350,000 at a peak, maybe around 1995. It's now down to about 250,000. The annual intake at the Defence Academy is now down to, it's halved from 5 years ago to about less than 1,000, about 800, I think. 800 to 1,000 a year. That tells you a lot that this is the next generation of officers. So if they've more than halved the intake of officers, you know that they've accepted the fact that this is not going to be a very big military compared to now in 5 years' time when those cadets graduate. So there's that. And then above all, you've got what I think Self described as a green to blue shift. So what you're seeing is an incredible beefing up of the police, the Myanmar police force, once known as corrupt, inept, not very well regarded, still under the military for administrative purposes, but no military, self-respecting military officer wanted to be a policeman. Now the police are, hey, they're sexy. They're getting a lot of funding from, it's permissible now for, the EU has just instituted a big program of training for police officers. And you know, clearly, with this upsurge, very worrying upsurge of sectarian violence, the security focus, and at the same time, sorry, it should be said, with peace agreements being negotiated, I'm not saying peace has broken out all over the place, but you can safely say that at least 11 significant peace agreements have been signed. Some say, I mean, the Myanmar Peace Centre, the government-funded arm, and also foreign-funded arm, of the government leading peace negotiations, claim that they've got, you know, 17 to 18 broad agreements with you know, any number of groups. But the main groups have all signed up, apart from the Kachin. There are problems with some of those existing peace agreements. They're very fragile. They could fall apart at any moment. But still, what you've got is you have not got a military that's trying to fight wars on, like, you know, 10 different fronts at once. They're mainly focused on about two fronts, and even that is not the full-on vicious kind of fighting we saw some years back, and also again briefly at the end of 2011 and 12, you had a lot of fighting in Kachin. These days it's sort of low-level conflict. Some of it can be nasty, but it's not the full-on warfare that that we were talking about before. So you've got a military that is seeing peace break out, and you've got a police that is under-equipped, under-trained, and trying to deal with these incredibly vicious upsurges of horrific violence against, mainly Buddhists against Muslims. The police have been way outnumbered. I know in a couple of the cases that that was one of the problems, why there hasn't been a response, but you know, the fact is a lot of people have been killed. There's 140,000 Muslims homeless at the moment, living in tents and makeshift refuges. And lately, which I'm sure if you're at a talk about Myanmar, you probably followed the latest problems up in northern Rakhine State, which actually points to another problem that I discussed with you earlier, which is Myanmar's risking a lot by not really dealing with this particular problem. They've gone fully into, you know, economic reforms and trying to reform all their institutions. This mental block or inability to really resolve the issue and the popular, I'd have to say, even hatred of a particular group of Muslims, commonly calling themselves Rohingya, who originated from Bengal, is a real problem that has resulted, I think, in largely this recent conditions that were attached to the $1.1 trillion US spending program signed by Barack Obama, that will really end up withdrawing funding and make life much harder for Myanmar. of. But when you're on the ground in Myanmar, you can't help feeling a bit pessimistic that that you know this can be resolved easily, because it's deeply entrenched right through the population. You're also obviously aware that even Aung San Suu Kyi, who herself has been a victim of you know, certain form of discrimination and military harassment, will not go out there and defend. So this is a problem. And I think, you know, I'll end on that note for now, and over to you.
Thank you. So when I listened to you talk about Burma, one of the things, you talk about these new power centers, and immediately wonder, when you talk about new economic power centers, who are they? Is this, and how did they get there? In other words, are we seeing a phenomenon in Burma similar to something we saw in Europe 20 years ago, the phenomenon of nomenclature capitalism? Is this former army people making the transition into the private sector? Or are these new people? Is this a new middle class being formed? How easy is it to become rich or even well off in Burma? What does it look like for entrepreneurs? How good are the laws? How easy is it to start a business? Or do you have to have connections already to go into business, or can you come up from the bottom? It seems to me this also is important for the future of politics there.
Yeah, that's a good 10 questions. It's a very valid point, but I presume you meant when you're saying the economic power center, you're talking about my reference to the business group.
You made a reference to shadowy or not shadowy business groups, so I'm wondering who are they, where do they come from?
Yesterday's cronies are, you know, I mean, there's probably new cronies forming as we speak, but actually...
Is it possible for ordinary people to also become...
Yes, I am addressing that question right now.
Okay.
Well, you know, for one thing, I think this government has actually focused on some, you know, lesser known and I suppose unsexy areas that actually have kicked through now and have enabled one to set up a company within 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. And I've interviewed a lot of people who have set up companies in 3 weeks or 4 weeks. And it is a little bit like these other transitional societies where if you've got half a brain, it doesn't have to be formal education, you have a good idea. It these days does not cost a lot of money to set up a company. And, you know, I don't know whether it's, you know, selling ice creams or, you know, putting your landline out on the road and selling phone calls to people. But there's a lot of people, there's a sort of new vibrance in the city, and I am talking mainly about the city. And let me just say, I'm not saying it's all wonderful. There's still problems in the rural areas. But these days, there is more of a chance for these ordinary people, as you say. But also, I think there is a mistaken impression that before you could not do business unless you were a crony. You could. It just took you a lot longer. It took 6 months to register a company, five or 6 months. Now it takes, you know, as I said, 3 weeks. There is a group called the Young Entrepreneurs Association, which is part of the UNFCCI. Everyone I've interviewed there, they're incredibly impressive. Young guys, and not so young, actually, you can still be a young entrepreneur at 40, I'm glad to note. when you turn 40, apparently you've sort of still got some sort of honorary membership, so you can keep feeling young. They're a very bright young bunch, but you make a good point, because a lot of the people setting up companies, I notice, do have education, but one of the newly rich I interviewed the other day was a young guy who grew up in Shan State with not a lot of education, helping his family's tea plantation business, not plantation. They went and picked their own tea leaves and carried enormous sacks and sold them, and he didn't speak English very well, but he started teaching himself, listening to the radio. He got a scholarship, a grant to learn English at the British Council. He learned English, he went out to be a tutor, and he saved all his money, and within, like, it took him 3 years, he opened a little school, and then he opened another little school, and now he's one of the richest English language training schools in Myanmar. And this guy
is without connections.
Yes, this guy has no connections. And I've met other people with no connections. And your reference to middle class is also interesting, because my feeling, and I can only go by, you know, the people I've talked to and what I've seen, and also figures on, you know, growth in certain sectors and businesses, but my feeling is that the middle class is rising. For one thing, the breakup of old monopolies, like, for example, the monopolies on car import and vehicle imports, which were held closely and controlled by military, by generals, and it used to cost $100,000 to get a car in, or else you could bring in an old rust bucket for, you know, I don't know how those rust buckets got in, but you'd be in a taxi and you'd be able to see the road through the floor at the back. It was that rusted. These days, ordinary people can buy little cars. There's a lot of taxi drivers I've had who speak good English and used to work as guest workers in Singapore or wherever. They've come back to give it a go. The only trouble and disincentive, I think, for a burgeoning middle class is these incredible costs now of Yangon. It's worse for expats, where the latest apartment block, I met sort of about eight different expatriates paying $8,000 to $15,000 a month for a 2 to 3 bedroom apartment in the middle of Yangon. Obviously, the taxi driver who came back from Singapore to give it a go is not living in those sort of places. But I think increasingly Yangon is becoming a little Hong Kong of Myanmar, and it's very difficult to live right downtown and be, you know, middle or working class.
And it is this, so it sounds, there is some energy, there is some entrepreneurship. Is this feeding back into politics, or could it feed back into politics?
Yes.
Is it, you spoke a little bit about the economic debate, you know, which is, as you say, unpredictable, does not fall in old lines anymore. Is there energy coming from whatever we call it, maybe it's not quite in the middle class yet, but from new entrepreneurs? Are those people pushing for further kinds of change?
Exactly. Yeah, I think one point is this. I touched on civil society and this Generation 88. I call a lot of those guys middle class. You know, they had a decent education. They were at university, so, you know, that puts them in a certain class. But there's a lot of groups like that that want to either do good or be involved in the political life. And I can see that, I mean, even this last by-election, there were quite a few independents running as independents, not part of party machinery. And it does seem like there's a new enthusiasm for, and I can see why. Why would anyone have been enthusiastic 5 years ago to get involved in political life under the SLAWG or SBDC? But these days, there's an enthusiasm to get involved. So you're seeing that. And but at the same time, it's very interesting to interview people like these young entrepreneurs who are largely middle class or maybe nomenclatura, because you do still need to set up a proper operation in tech or media or whatever. You need funding. And banks are still not giving credit and loans very easily, which is a huge problem, and I might come back to banking later. But a lot of the young people I've interviewed who've been educated abroad or even in Myanmar, but I'd say a lot of the young entrepreneurs have been educated in, a lot of them are educated in Singapore, actually. But, you know, a lot of them do not care that much about the ideology of politics. They've said to me, we only care really about having a government that is decent, that, you know, runs the country, but lets us get on with doing business. Doesn't impede us, possibly helps us. And I think that's a very interesting and quite striking, actually.
I mean, whole political parties have been organized around that idea.
Yeah.
Government should be decent and help us get on.
Yeah, no, but I'm saying the other thing, no, but it's in the Myanmar context, which has been so deeply divided, and
right,
you'd automatically consider, if you weren't pro-military kind of out there saying, you know, we need order and we need to put troublemakers in jail. If you weren't one of those, then you were really pro-NLD, you admired Aung San Suu Kyi. I think this new generation, the really new generations, they don't actually care about Aung San Suu Kyi or Thein Sein. You know, I said, who will you vote for in 2000? 2015. Most of them are saying, we don't know, we'll just see who's got the better policies for business. And this is really unprecedented.
And is there, are there parties forming around that idea? Is that affecting the way politics are being shaped?
I think it's too early for the formation of parties. As I said, I think something like this Generation 88 or some of the other civil society groups might end up forming parties. No one wants to declare yet. It's still about, let's not forget, it's nearly 2 years off the election. So, as I said, anything could happen between now and then. But it's a very interesting thought. And I think, actually, some of the more savvy young entrepreneurs might end up going to politics. But, you know, actually, the savviest ones, I think, just want to get on with their business and build it up.
I want to ask you about sanctions, but before I do, are there because it's a large group and I'm sure very knowledgeable. Are there people who want to comment on what's been said so far or contribute? Sorry, there's one right there.
Do we need a microphone or can everybody hear?
I suspect that for the purposes of.
I just wanted to add a few thoughts to the discussion.
Oh yes, sorry. Could you identify yourself?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Priscilla Clapp. I'm retired from the State Department, but I was the chargé in Rangoon a few years ago. I'd just like to add something to the discussion you were having about who the cronies are and the relationship between the new business and the old cronies. The ones that the U.S. government identifies on the special
SDN
list come from the last regime. They were connected in with the top generals in the last regime, and some of those generals were extremely corrupt, including Ban Shui, probably the richest man in the country. And they controlled the whole economy, and they helped certain selected civilian businessmen to do business. And they allowed them to reach into the ministries and grab whatever they wanted. A lot of those connections have been broken very deliberately by this government. You don't see it yet, you don't hear about it yet, but people inside who are working on policy have told me that they're making a conscious effort to break those channels of communication into the ministries. Furthermore, the old cronies, the old generals, have been pushed aside. There are some still hanging around, well, certainly in the parliament ministries, but they don't have the access into the economy that they once had. So you can't, the old cronies, are very wealthy, but they can't sustain it through that kind of business anymore. They have to sort of become more legit. There's still a question about whether this new government will create yet a new class of crony capitalists, but they are actually trying to take measures to stop this from happening. And they're also trying to introduce transparency into government contracts, government business, which should help. It'll take a long time. But anyway, just wanted to add that. Thanks.
Yeah, no, that's a very good point about, and you know, I think the term
What's inspiring you to deliberately break the links between the old business class and,
in my first interview with Tang, I've met Tang Sein quite a few times, but the first interview was in about a year after he came to power in mid-2012, and that was one of the first things he was talking about was how they saw the removal of sanctions as absolutely critical to the, you know, progress of reform.
So this is about the removal of sanctions?
I'm bringing it back to the crony thing, which is, that's why they couldn't break the links. For example, the military's vast holding companies, UNEHL, MEC, you know, and I can see a couple of people in the audience who know a lot more than me about all this, but you've got very concerted efforts to get military connected companies off the SDN list, and also these connections, cronies into the government, are seen as an impediment if they're going to attract the attention or if any of these people are still on the so-called blacklist. Now you've got quite a few of these so-called cronies on the blacklist hiring top Washington law firms, lobbying like crazy to get off that list. And
do you want to back up 1 second and explain what you mean, what the list is?
It's the SDN, specially designated nationals list, which is, it's not just people, it's, and correct me if I'm wrong, But it's not just people, it can be ships, I believe, and companies, so inanimate as well as animate. But anyway, so that's the, that's my brain. sorry, I'll just lost my microphone. Yeah, so I think that's the problem with that's the problem with, as far as the government is concerned, they see the crony connection
as one of the things that might inspire U.S. or our international sanctions.
Exactly. But that said, let's just say that, in fact, there was much surprise at the, you know, some of the big contracts, and the government has been very praised for things like conducting the telecommunications tender in a clean, transparent manner, in which they chose two foreign companies to get the most lucrative telecommunications licenses in the country has ever given. Well, in fact, the only ones they've given the private sector. But at the same time,
so somehow they're motivated by the fear or the desire to lift sanctions.
No, I was going to say it.
Or they're motivated by something else.
Yeah, no, I was going to say at the same time, you've had sort of the letting of some big contracts like airport upgrades, which went to Asia World, which is one of the big so-called crony companies. So you've got mixed signals, and that was a very mixed signal because that came out around the same time as the telecommunications deal, where everyone was commending the government for being so clean and open and then, you know, resisting pressure and going for the best bidders who were foreign. There were no foreign local partners. And then, you know, they awarded this other contract to... They claim that, you know, that was simply the best bid and most competitive. Who knows? We'll see, you know, the next big contracts to be given out are these 30 offshore oil and gas concessions, which have drawn huge amount of interest. Some of them could be potentially extremely lucrative, they're deep water and shallow water, so we'll see how that process goes. There's other tenders coming up, and overall, I think from my conversations with foreign business, the whole, can I say that the whole crony syndrome, actually, for foreign business, it's a problem because there are not many, so dominant were these big crony companies that they are the ones who are really experienced. They're the ones that know how to get a road built within, you know, 3 months. They can do an airport. They can build a hotel overnight. You know, non-crony companies who never got any contracts don't actually have much experience. So in everyone from Coca-Cola and Pepsi need local partners. The local partners most suitable are companies that actually have the experience. If they're on the SDN list, American companies cannot even contemplate doing business with them. So this is this transition period, and there are differing shades of grey, I think, on this question of crony companies.
Sorry, there are a couple of questions. One.
Issue in the peace talks, in the economics, and it's everything from the price of apartments in Rangoon down to, you know, ethnic conflict. And if you could talk a little bit more about that and how international players factor into it. And it's also related to China's involvement in the Burmese economy. And there were just stories this week about MPs in the parliament complaining about the pipeline across Kachin State, raising very specific questions about the safety of the pipeline. And
this is the Chaoqiu pipeline going from Rakhine State across to Yunnan?
Yes, there are just yesterday and today, the Burmese press reporting about questions being raised by Burmese parliamentarians about problems with the pipeline.
Right.
And so new potential for conflict between Burma and China over resource extractive industries that have local impacts in Burma.
Right. So that was about four questions.
They're all related to land.
No, I'll
land,
I'll just address the land thing. I think, as you pointed out, the issue of land ownership, title, grabbing, and getting it back is so complex. And as you said, ranges from, you know, the farmers, you know, just like farmer with a plot of land to, you know, vast tracts. So, sorry, I've got this phone going here. I was going to say, it's one of the big issues that could possibly, you know, sort of derail things seriously. What we're seeing right now is it feeds in, as you say, even to this special economic zone. The pipelines, the next thing is China wanted to build a railway that goes across from that roughly tracks the pipeline. That's only a narrow corridor, but it means if you want even a high speed or medium speed rail, you're going to cut through that whole country. You need more land. That said, I'd have to say there's again, it's very mixed signals on land grabbing, because you've had some very pretty brutal responses on one level, and on another level, I was in a place in Cairns State the other day where the government had actually compensated locals who'd been thrown off their land but moved to other land in a different place, and the locals who I interviewed were very angry and said, we will see, this will be the big test, will the government live up to its promises? I went back, they had, you know, they paid the people for the land. In other cases, it's totally unjust. So there is no easy formula. It's an absolute can of worms for this government, and they know it. I think that's why they've been taking their time. And there's several places this will be played out. One will be Parliament, where there were land use bills and they were inadequate, they come to grief. So that's being renegotiated. There's several bills, that's again complicated, use of fallow land, use of agricultural land. One thing is for sure, that Tan Sein, in every interview I've heard him talk about land, is he's well and truly committed himself to making progress, and there is a process now for land title. What they've got to do, another thing is, land title is spread over 2 to 3 ministries. It involves forestry, it involves agriculture. There's a new ministry, rural affairs. And so you've got that as well in the equation. And meanwhile, you've got locals being empowered and being shown their way. I went down to Tiloa, the new Japanese-funded economic zone. Locals there, you walk in, they're so well organized, Google Maps, satellite images blown up on the wall, they've got press releases coming out. The Chao Phu people, the Shui Gas group, incredibly well organized, press releases, photos, briefings, booklets. We're going to see more and more of this. So one thing's for sure, I don't think people are actually going to end up being completely brushed aside, ignored and downtrodden, because there's too much activism going on now in the country. There's so many situations where people are, rising up or taking.
So because of the new democracy or because of the openness of debate, it's now not possible. People plan to be taken without any repercussions.
But can I just say, the other thing to be really aware of is that there's all these cases where it turns out the same piece of land has been sold 4 times. So actually, 4 people genuinely believe it's their land. So who's going to decide that? The courts. This becomes a problem with the judiciary as well, which, they need a lot of help. I mean, I was in a courtroom that had 1 typewriter. They don't even have a computer. And, there's a lot of law firms trying to do trainings there. What worries me again, in turn, is with trainings you've got lots of people wanting to help, but that means that you've got lots of different approaches. And, one group is training one lot of courts, another group's training. How do we know that they're all being trained in the same way? Land is that complicated, and that's why I don't think, a lot of skeptics, cynics and critics have accused the government of reneging or dragging their feet and not being sincere about the land thing. Personally, I think the more time, the better, because if you try and solve this overnight, you're going to get some pretty bad solutions and pretty bad legislation, which is what happened in the first place with these half-baked land bills. and this is what's happened with the special economic zone law, which was recalled and being redone.
Okay, I'll take a couple more questions. Sorry, there's one right here. And then we'll slowly draw to a close.
Hello. My name is Nick Moros. I'm with TD International. My question is about the pipelines, the China-Burmese pipelines, and then you had mentioned the offshore fields. What is your perception of, you know, energy projects in Burma and their role in the country's economic development? And then what are the perceptions of the sector within the country?
So when you say energy projects, though, do you mean like oil and gas exploration,
yeah,
or do you mean like power generation?
Oil and gas. Extraction,
okay.
And export.
Right. Well, one thing to be aware of, and I think this is an interesting thing that maybe has escaped some people, but from the very first time I interviewed not just Thein Sein, but some of his Uber cabinet, U Sow Thein, who is in charge of a lot of the economic stuff, the first thing they've been going on about signing this EITI, the Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative, which is kind of a voluntary initiative that has worked quite well for some, particularly in Africa and other places, in terms of this is signed up by governments and companies and local communities. So Myanmar's about to sign that. They've been working on it for ages. The Australians are helping them, the Norwegians, which administer, I believe, EITI. That will usher in a new set of standards in all kinds of extractive industries, and it will also apply, I believe, to oil and gas. So there is the will there of the government to make a much more transparent process in the extractive industries, particularly on oil and gas. It's always been a problem. The revenues have been a black hole. The government has now, I mean, that's clear. They're much more transparent. The, I was just reading, a lot of material has come out about revenues, what's coming out of where. As I said, the oil and gas tenders are quite transparent. The Chinese project, okay, the one thing is, in at the same time as this government is thinking of renegotiating the, signing up to the EITI, they're clearly moving to renegotiate some of these earlier contracts that they now see as inequitable, unfair. They've already brought it up with the Thais, where the Thais are taking gas straight out of, I think Myanmar's providing about something incredible like 60% or 50%, don't quote me on that, of gas to Bangkok straight through a pipeline. And the Chinese one is absolutely critical for the Chinese to get that gas across to Yunnan. But let's also remember that that's a twin pipeline, and the other pipeline is oil, which the Chinese are shipping in from the Middle East and sticking into a pipeline, that pipeline that will run, that is running parallel to the gas that they're pumping out of the sea, but that is being pumped by the Koreans. So you've got this incredible race of interests in that dual pipeline across. That also is, I believe, under renegotiation, or will be, and the Chinese know that, they've accepted it. I actually went to that island. I think the Chinese thought I was an investor or something, so they were quite they were quite nice to me. And I, when they found it, I was a journalist, they weren't very happy. But that was still early. They hadn't. It was just about to start pumping, and it was a very interesting operation because they were clearly thinking about more projects like that. And they just see it as a lifeline for Yunnan. In Yunnan, they've got too much inventory, they can't get their goods out, they desperately need transport out. The idea of a railway is their next holy grail, but also to get the power in, to get gas coming in. So they're not going to let go of that very easily. But I do know that the main Chinese companies that were involved in the Chaopu project and also in a couple of others are very wary now of the direction Myanmar's heading. That's not to say, like, you know, I was looking at the foreign investment figures the other day. I mean, China accounts for, like, a huge amount of Myanmar's total foreign investment, and still does, and still will. So the perception that they're actually dumping the Chinese is just not true. I think it was $14 billion out of $42 billion total that's gone in since 88 is from China, and that's just the official stuff. Can you imagine with jade, teak, you know, minerals of all sorts? None of that. I think a lot of that is not declared. So I don't think China is going anywhere fast, but I think with oil and gas there will be a lot more transparency.
So you've talked about some of the things the government... Oh, I'm sorry, yes. I'm Christian Carl, editor of Democracy Lab, part of the family, as it were. So you've talked a lot about government economic policy. Tell us a little bit about the economic policies of Aung San Suu Kyi, who now could conceivably, potentially, theoretically, become president in 2015.
That's right. Well, we'll know more about that when the Constitutional Review Committee reports, supposedly on the 31st, although they had said that they're just going to lay out the proposals, and there are definitely proposals to change the Article 59F that currently bars her from being eligible to stand for the presidency. But I think from previous discussions, Christian, you might know that I am concerned that... I have not seen great evidence from both Aung San Suu Kyi and her party of huge interest or grasp or preparation on the economic policy front. And if we talk, this talk is supposed to address the role of economic reform and policy in the democratic transition. And so far, I remember trying to ask her about what she thought the ideal exchange rate was for Myanmar when the government was struggling to unify exchange rates and set up a daily auction system that would stabilize the exchange rate after a managed float of the chat. And she did not want to answer that question because I don't think she probably really had thought about what the ideal exchange rate was for farmers and other people in Myanmar. I think, you know, that said, I know that the NLD is getting a lot of offers of help from governments. A lot of help from governments and aid organisations and also individuals, you know, very high-powered lawyers and other entities, think tanks that want to help the NLD devise good, solid policies and a solid election campaign. And I think there's far too much focus on this Clause 59F and if Aung San Suu Kyi will run or not, and it's seen as everything or nothing. In fact, if the constitution is not changed in time, then, okay, so maybe she can't be president. She will run. She will be a force. She could be Speaker of Parliament. She will be a force on the political scene. And her party will also be a force because they will win big. That is, if she is, you know, alive and well and running in those elections, I'm quite sure she will be a force. I'd like to see her maybe take more of an interest and be more active on the economic front, actually.
Do you have the sense that she avoids economics because it's controversial or that it doesn't interest her, or what's the source of difficulty?
Well, I'd say the latter, yeah. I don't see a great deal of interest or engagement with, I mean, you know, she's certainly not a stupid woman, and she's very articulate, and I think, you know, possibly if she was running the country, she'd become a whole lot more interested in economics. But I've seen her speak in many, many forums and been asked many questions that touch on economics. Her forte and her interest are social welfare policies, health, education, those kind of areas. But hopefully, you know, I mean, I think some great leaders in the world are not particularly interested in economics, but have a great talent for getting the right people, and she certainly has so much goodwill that she could get the best people and the best brains in Myanmar. My question is, why hasn't she? You know, you go to the NLD and you want to talk about economic policy. They don't have any, I mean, set economic policies. That said, it's just like the rest of Myanmar. There's too much to do. They can't do everything overnight. This party is not going to wheel out a whole set of economic policies just like that. I think they're working on it now.
Right. Although, yes. There are two in-house questions. Why don't you ask? Why don't we have both of them?
Thanks. say your names for the...
Chris Walker, the NED, and it's a related question. You had mentioned, Gwen, at the outset that what in essence were normal politics starting to edge their way into Burmese life in the sense that you now have new dividing lines. You have these pro-market, I think it was a kind of crude division you gave, but nevertheless pro-market on one side, protectionist on the other. How would you see the pro-market oriented forces shaping arguments and messages that would resonate with a wider public that may be economically illiterate, who would invariably confront painful dimensions of any sort of meaningful reform? What would be the sort of kind of strokes that would be effective, in your view, for those forces to communicate to ensure at least some modicum of progress?
Right. Sorry, I didn't mean to sort of be overly crude in boiling it down to pro-market, anti-market, or, you know, protectionist versus pro-market. And as I said, there are many shades of grey. I think there's some interesting debates going on that would be quite instructive in your question. So, for example, right now, there's the next big fight is going to be about the entry of foreign banks to Myanmar. So right now, foreign banks have flooded in to have representative offices. So there's, you know, many more than 30, nearly 40, I believe, foreign banks that have set up rep offices. Only 3 years ago, there was only, I think there was less than sort of, you know, 17 or 15. And that is being built. That's an interesting one because amongst the local banking community, the big banks are actually welcoming any step towards letting foreign banks in on a limited basis. So the idea is to let maybe a handful of foreign banks in, either to set up branches that are very limited to maybe certain wholesale and corporate banking, maybe a little bit, I'm not sure, they're just formulating this. But the smaller banks feel very threatened, just like they do over the foreign investment law. Your point was, how do these pro-market forces communicate to, what did you call them, the kind of man in the street?
It
depends what sector you're talking about, but I think, for example, with the bank thing, if you've got a foreign bank coming in to say, we can facilitate mortgages are still illegal in Myanmar. You can't get a mortgage, you can't buy a house if you don't have the money. It's very hard to get a loan. In that way, I think, for example, even poor people who may not have a bank account, but they're seeing all these ATMs on the streets now, that kind of, you know, even anyone who works has a bit of saving. And faith in the part of the population from the semi-literate to the literate was destroyed in banks with the banking crisis of 2003. And before that, the mad demonetization policies of Nguyen Win three times. You know, he wiped out three quarters of the money, the cash, overnight in 1987. So people do not trust banks. I think, you know, they see these signs for, you know, Standard Chartered or, you know, whatever. It makes them feel good. And I think on some levels that the entry of some of these in some sectors, like the foreign food thing, I mean, the excitement of, you know, some of these brands, like still waiting for the Golden Arches to appear in Yangon, but I'm sure that, you know, those noodle vendors on the street will love to see McDonald's there. I mean, it depends what you're talking about in terms of, you know, the pro-market forces and selling this message to the locals. But it's a very interesting period that it's in now. It's all
sorry. One and then two. Why don't we take a couple of questions since there are now several. So.
Yeah. Brian Jones with the NED. My question is sort of the normalization or the unearthing of the black market economy. So not only did they demonetize currency, but they normalized the exchange rate. But the other part of Burma's economy, which is often neglected in these conversations, is the drug economy. How is that, in your opinion, affecting the larger economic trends in the country? I mean, how important is it to economic reform and to the political change taking place?
So drug economy, let's take one other question.
And Mike Rossetti, PBS Online NewsHour. What risk is there of spillover if the Thai Democrats succeed in the process of destroying democracy in Thailand, and then there, or if there's a military coup, or at worst, a civil war?
Okay.
Can I start with Thailand first? Because I've just flown from Thailand. I live in Thailand half the time. I live in Myanmar the other half of the time. So both stories are very close to my heart. That's really an interesting question. A, because there's some perception, and already, you know, there's a lot of commentary you're seeing about what countries would be the winners from Thailand's woes. Well, you know, people say Vietnam, Myanmar. Myanmar's opening up. Companies in Thailand are getting very nervous. This is much nastier than I've ever seen at Thailand, and I was living there for a while in the 80s. I missed the 1976 Thammasat problems, but this is really something else. So I think that on one level, on a purely cynical economic commercial level, you might see an acceleration in plans by companies that are in Thailand who have been eyeing Myanmar. And let's not forget that there's a lot that's grey between Thailand and Myanmar, mainly because their borders, you know, there's a lot of border trade, there's also a lot of, you know, under the radar business. But on a higher level, you've got the Japanese, big Japanese companies building Tilawa economic zone in Myanmar, and the Japanese companies in Thailand who account for about 60% of the industrial base of Thailand. They're so big, the Japanese in Thailand. Some of those companies are the same ones involved in, say, building Tilawa economic zone in Myanmar. They're also eyeing, I mean, this is a brand new consumer market for a lot of Western and developed country companies of 60 million or more. We'll know when the census is finally, the census is another issue. So I think, you know, there's some concerns on the part of Thailand that maybe, you know, companies that are nervous in Thailand might sort of think, well, maybe we should step up our plans to move over or set up alternative or supplementary industrial facilities in Myanmar. So I think you'll see some benefit there. Also, Myanmar had an enormous, relatively, garment industry before US sanctions kicked in on the import. Was it the Burma Act that taking Myanmar imports? 2003, the garment industry like crashed. It used to have 350,000 workers. It went down to 60,000, to give you an idea. That garment industry is now building back up. And I was sitting there, you know, there's a flood of big name brands coming in, you know, H&M, Gap. They all want to suss out the factories and set up there. I think that you might see, particularly Cambodia, there's this huge upheavals and workers being shot. I mean, Myanmar's actually, in some levels, looming as quite sort of, you know, stable, unless you're in Rakhine State and you're a Rohingya living under a piece of plastic in a swampy field. But apart from that, you know, that's one way. The other thing is Thailand was absolutely instrumental in ASEAN, and its role, its official role in ASEAN at the moment is China liaison to ASEAN in the plus-plus dialogues. And even with this caretaker government, this Yingluck, who was, let's say, democratically elected and won a big landslide vote, but even as caretaker, this government cannot make any negotiations, it can't sign any pacts, it can't, you know, it's useless in ASEAN, it can't fulfill its roles. Myanmar is chairman of ASEAN this year, and they just hosted the kickoff meeting of foreign ministers. Thailand wasn't there, Cambodia's not there, because that's blowing up as well. So I think that will be another consequence, is the impact it'll have on ASEAN, and therefore Myanmar, because Myanmar, it's such a crucial year for them. This is the coming out of Myanmar. The real legitimization is to be chairman of ASEAN, which was a group that was getting distinctly uncomfortable with the generals and the whole kind of negative publicity about human rights abuses before. So it's particularly symbolic for Myanmar to make a success of this ASEAN year. And without, you know, Thailand has been handling all the China stuff. It was seen as possibly helping on the South China Sea strategic issues as well as business. So I think that's another part of it. on drug economy, which was a good question, and it's not my forte, but I do know that, I mean, particularly from looking at a lot of the UNODC stuff, and they've made big inroads on crop replacement and opium. And the opium trade is sort of, as you probably know, is a shadow of its former self. But what you've had is this huge increase in crystal meth labs, which people say is sort of a great cottage industry in northern Myanmar and on the Chinese border. A lot of it is inside China. There's also scattered around the peripheries of Myanmar. A lot of it's flooding into Thailand. It's very lucrative, but a lot of it is really under the radar because this stuff is being cooked in sort of little workshops. You can just hire a little cottage and be churning out crystal meth and sort of, you know, shipping it in across the border to Thailand. It's very easy to make, and, well, comparatively easy, I gather. I've made it myself. And very lucrative. So I think that's sort of an area to look at, but I'm not quite. UNODC definitely has identified this as the problem drug of this generation, and it's certainly acquired a lot of popularity in Thailand. You know, heroin's old hat in Southeast Asia, apart from sort of some parts of northern Myanmar where you've got a lot of heroin addicts in certain areas, but it's not a huge deal, and I think the crop substitution has worked quite well.
Yesterday's problem. There was a question in the back.
Rick O'Sullivan, Champion Solutions Civil Society Economist and the Chair of City of Washington Civil Society Work Group. My question is about civil society and the apolitical side of civil society. When you talk about civil society activity, especially in forms such as these, it's always about political parties and influencing the government. But I'm talking about the role of civil society taking on direct responsibility for managing the economy or managing social services, trade associations that create their own certification standards, and our local community water co-ops. So it's not, are you pro-government, are you pro-opposition? I'm pro-fresh water. I think everyone can get behind that. So when you talk about civil society development, could you talk about the non-political? I see as a measure of democratic health the percentage of the civil society economy that is not engaged in political involvement.
Right.
Well, where does that stand?
I think that's interesting that you'd call a trade association that's, say, dealing with water or something civil society. In fact, the trade associations, which are, play a really critical role, but I think I put them more in the business category. They've been very instrumental. Would you?
Self-organized groups.
Well,
yeah.
Not organized by the government.
A successful business association does not, as you hear, represent the interest of its members. It represents the interest of its members' customers. A cartel works on behalf of the members, but an association is supposed to grow the whole market.
Right.
And so, for example, the American Medical Association doesn't say that our job is to protect doctors, it's to ensure all Americans access to
health.
In any case,
the health of apolitical associations and groups, can you speak of?
Yeah.
The status of them.
Yeah. They exist, are they numerous?
Well, I think
does the law protect them?
Yeah, I think that is actually at a very early stage at the moment. I mean, you've got things like, I don't know if this also qualifies, but, you know, groups I've been really impressed with are things like free funerals. I don't know if anyone knows that. They're an incredible group, actually, and they do very good work in Myanmar. They're not just a sort of charitable organization helping, because funerals are very expensive in Myanmar, but they also have a medical operation with a lot of doctors volunteering. They're kind of quite a force. They almost exist in spite of law and government not really helped by them. And I don't know if they actually want backing of the government, but they're certainly not impeded by, in the bad old days, they were impeded by laws because they were seen as a huge threat. You know, to have an independent, you know, a separate, and they were seen as subversive. And anyone even dealing with things like AIDS or, you know, medical things like that, clean water, you know, The best group I know of is Proximity, which is a fantastic group doing a lot for farmers, and mainly farmers. They've just gone into microfinance. So where you're really seeing a lot of movement now is the microfinance community, which is not, it's almost hybrid. I wouldn't even put it as, I mean, I guess they broadly classify as financial services, but they're almost a charity. Are they classified as civil society? I don't know. But that's a very interesting area to look at too. But you'll find that I think it's at a very early stage, and that there isn't the sort of conceptual framework there of what.
But it's beginning to happen.
It's beginning, yeah, definitely, definitely.
Okay, we'll take one more question. Oh, no, I'm sorry, did you? Okay, yes. And then.
Solid clap again. Gwen, the big question we're always asking ourselves, is it reversible? Mm-hmm. Let me put it in a slightly different way for you. Do you think that the momentum of the economic reforms and opening up of the economy and what it's doing for the people there can act as an inhibition, let's say, on reversibility of the political side of it? Do people have a big enough stake on the economic side to see what the consequences of political reversal would be at this point? I'm looking at 2015 and beyond.
Yeah. Well, that's exactly, yeah, I don't think I sort of communicated that point very well, but I do believe that the more people can be convinced they have a stake, then the more irreversible it will become. But at this point, how you approach that question of irreversibility is really about whether you believe truly that, whether you believe that Tan Shui and his, the darker forces generals are either out of the picture, or if it's all like, an elaborate setup, as some people seem to think it is. And that goes back to the question of the impetus of reform and the timing, why he did what he did, when he did, and why he took himself out of the picture, and if he fully is out of the picture, or if it's all a trick. But something tells me that even if it was all a trick, as you point out quite rightly, the speed with which these changes are happening, I don't think even the wily old man would have anticipated. So my feeling is, and when I walk around in Yangon, and you do sometimes think, 88 must have been like that. I wasn't there then. But when, troops came out and started firing into crowds, would this happen again? Actually, no, because I think they're rotating these military officers, for example, in parliament. And that's a lot of people. That's 25% of 664, and I've forgotten what the exact number is. But, some years it's changed once or twice. They've just appointed four women colonels or majors to parliament. So they're the first women military officers to go into parliament. So you've got this sort of consciousness raising that's actually happening in the military too. And also at the same time, as I said, these numbers in the military are going down hugely. I just can't see the military being as willing, even if the top general says, go out in the street and shoot those people. I think this time you might get a bit of a rebellion on your hands, but I wouldn't like to put it to the test. But my feeling is that it's gone beyond the point where you could go back to, rearrest 3,000 people to put them in sort of jail to be tortured. I mean, military intelligence, which did a lot of the surveillance, I mean, that's actually broken up a lot of it. It became Special Branch that took over that. But this apparatus is not there as it was anymore. So I think it would be extremely hard to bring it all back overnight, and it would take an extraordinary situation. And let's not forget, the sort of situation to enable that to happen would have to be declared as a state of emergency. And under this constitution, there's only one person who can declare a state of emergency, and that's not the commander-in-chief, it's the president. And I can't see Tame saying willingly declare a state of emergency, in which case the military then takes over. So I think we're pretty safe for the next 2 years, touchwood, and beyond, because I think the elections will be the very big test. But my feeling is they will make it to the elections, and there is no way it can be the kind of fraudulent sham that it has been in the past, because there'll be too many people looking, there'll be too many observers, and And by then, if things go the way they are now, it'll be well and truly irreversible. Anyway, that's my feeling. I don't like to.
Right, on that extremely optimistic note.